Hello everyone, today I shall be covering food processing, food fortification. Hello everyone, today I shall be covering food processing, food fortification and food adulteration. This whole topic will be covered in two lectures. So first, what is food processing? Food processing is a process of transforming raw ingredients into food for various forms for human consumption, either at domestic level or by food processing industry. So what are the advantages of food processing? It makes the food safer and product with long life. It makes the food more attractive apart from refining the color, appearance and taste. It also enhances the quality of food. This process also adds extra nutrients in the form of minerals and vitamins to foods. Food processing increases the seasonal availability of many foods. It kills harmful bacteria or other microorganisms and renders safety to the foods for checking the growth of pathogenic microbes. It has made possible the long distance transportation of perishable food items. So this eases marketing and distribution of food. So what are the disadvantages of food processing? Food processing may reduce the nutritional value of food items. Heat-sensitive vitamins like vitamin C can be lost. Water-soluble vitamins are lost while washing items with water. Certain food preservatives are allergic or even carcinogenic. Processing food may contain very high calories. Processing may also increase the price of food products. So these are the few commonly used food processing techniques like pickling. We have pickles, carbonated cold drinks, we have cans of juices, fruits, even foods, fish like. Then the cooking, frying, grilling of food, baking of bread, making jam and jelly, brewing, pasteurization of milk. These all are the examples of food processing. The next topic is the food additives. The food additives are non-nutritious elements added deliberately to food, usually in controlled quantities, to enhance its appearance, texture, and flavors. Food additives can be derived from flora, fauna, or mineral, or maybe synthetic. Food additives can be grouped into two broad categories. Number one is additives intentionally added to food, for example, coloring agents like saffron, turmeric, flavoring agents like vanilla essence, sweeteners like saccharin, cyclamate. Then we have preservatives like sorbic acid, sodium benzoate, acidity imparting agents like acetic acid, thickening agents like alginate and casein, which are used in ice creams, cheese, yogurt, etc. We also have emulsifiers, those retain water and oil mixed together. Example, lecithin, monoglycerides and diglycerides are used in margarine, baked goods and ice cream. We also have antioxidants as additives, which checks spoilage, change in taste and color, loss due to exposure to air, for example, vitamin C and vitamin E. The second category of food additives is contaminants. Incidental entry at various stages like packing, processing and farming practices, for example, insecticides. So, law and regulation related to food additives. Possible harmful effect of food additives on health of human being need to be explored before following its uses. In India, two such legal provisions related to food additives are: first, the Prevention of Food Adulteration Act, PFA, and the second one is the Food Products Order. Food additive is labeled as an adulterant in case low dose not permit its use. The food is also considered adulterated if maximum permissible limits are voided for any food additive. As per the law, it is mandatory to print the quantity of the additive on the label affixed to the container. The word artificially colored must be printed on the label if any external coloring agent is added to the food. The Joint FAO and WHO Expert Committee on Food Additives is an international agency that evaluates the safety profile of food additives. Every food additive has to get safety clearance from this agency, then the Codex Alimentarius Commission provides maximum use levels. Only such food additives can be used in food. Then the food preservatives. One cannot consume food immediately on production in routine hectic life. So we have to preserve the food for later use. The process of food decay and deterioration sets in as food is cooked due to the enzymes and the chemical present in it. Environmental factors like temperature, humidity amplify the decay. This food decay and deterioration renders the food unfit for human consumption. So it's required for enhancing the keeping quality of food, preserve the nutritional characteristics of food, retains the appearance, color and texture of the food. So types of preservatives. Natural preservatives. Most commonly used natural preservatives are the naturally occurring and easily available items such as table salt and sugar. High osmotic pressure does not permit bacteria to propagate when the salt is added. Salt has been used to make pickles. Sugar is added in syrup from the fruits to increase their shelf life and to conserve them like jams and jellies. Another set of natural preservatives are the ones that target enzymes that are present in fruits and vegetables. These enzymes are the ones that continue to act or metabolize even after the fruits are cut. For example, citric and ascorbic acid present in lemon juice inhibits the enzyme phenolase that is responsible for browning of the cut surface of apples and potatoes. Herbs, spices, and vinegar are other examples of natural preservatives. Antioxidants. Antioxidants preserve food articles by preventing spoilage and limit changes in flavor and color loss caused by atmospheric exposure. Vitamin C and vitamin E are such examples. There are various other antioxidants preservatives such as butylated hydroxanisole BHA. Then we have antimicrobial preservatives. These preservatives play an important role in the prevention of microbial growth and multiplication. For example, benzoic acid, sulfur dioxide, ethanol, sodium nitrate, sulfites, and disodium ethylene diamine tetraacetic acid, EDTA. Microbes as preservatives. Some of the microbes, due to their microbial activity, are used for the production of food as well as in preservation of food items. For example, cheese, flavoring agents, etc. Fungi such as yeast ferment sugars and produce alcohol, which in turn leads to food preservation. Radiation. One of the modern methods of food preservation which uses radiation such as radioactive rays or high intensity X-rays or streams of electrons. As the food irradiated is done when it is already in the packets, there is minimal percent to food contact, thus reducing contamination. Radiation may cause some changes in color, however the food is not turned radioactive. Radiation may also prolong the shelf lives of perishable foods items such as strawberries, potatoes, etc. Health concerns on food preservatives, such as bronchial asthma on exposure to sulfur dioxide used to preserve wines and allergic reactions because of preservatives. Implication of nitrates as carcinogen is reported in few studies. Suspected toxic effects of food preservatives. These are the few examples like antimicrobials, preservatives is benzoic acid, toxic effects is allergies, sorbic acid we have contact allergies, sulfites we have allergies, nitrites and nitrates we have carcinogenesis, methemoglobinemia, and antioxidants like BHT is shown mouse liver carcinogen, BHA also rat stomach carcinogen, alkyl chelates, allergy, fetal and neonatal toxicity is reported. Is food fortification. Food fortification is defined as the process whereby nutrients are added to food in relatively small quantities to maintain or improve the quality of diet of group, a community or a population. In fortification, the level of nutrients added surpasses their natural level in the food item. So, what is the need of fortification? India harbors nearly one-third of the population suffering from vitamin and micronutrient deficiency across the globe. Almost 70% of Indian population consumes less than 50% of recommended dietary allowances for micronutrients, resulting in high incidence of anemia, vitamin A deficiency and iodine deficiency disorders. Food fortification is very cost-effective and scalable public health intervention. The French physician Washing Galt recommended adding of iodine with salt to avoid goiter in the year 1831. However, it was introduced as a strategy to address micronutrient malnutrition in 1920. Ever since, the paradigm of food fortification has evolved in terms of coverage of micronutrient and food products and has led to near eradication of various micronutrient deficiencies in many countries. Some of the fortification programs are, which are very popular, wheat flour, launched by the Government of India in February 1970 in Bombay for fortification of atta with edible groundnut flour to improve its vitamin, minerals and protein content. Iodization of salt, for prevention and control of endemic goiter, 30 parts per million of iodine potassium iodate at manufacture level is added and it should be available at 15 parts per million at consumer level when you are adding the salt to food as per the Prevention of Food Adulteration Act. Fortification of Vanaspati Ghee, Butter and Milk is compulsory for vitamin A and vitamin D. 2500 international unit of vitamin A and 175 international unit of vitamin D per 100 gram of Vanaspati are added as per the Government of India. Double fortification of salt. Addition to iodine, iron is added to common salt for prevention of nutritional anemia. Then we have fluoridation of water for prevention of dental caries. For fortification, the following criteria must be fulfilled by the nutrient which you are adding and the vehicle which is carrying it. The vehicle fortified has to be taken consistently as portion of the regular daily diet. So you have to take that vehicle in which nutrient is added daily basis. The nutrient should not be hazardous. The addition of the nutrient should not change taste, odor or appearance of the food. The cost of fortification should not be beyond the reach of the population. So the cost should not escalate when you add some nutrient to the food. So what are the benefits of fortification? This is the cost effective and avoids main micronutrient deficiency at minor cost. No need to change the dietary habits of the end users. Population based approach. So it benefits the large number of people or a community. Relatively quick implementation and easily sustainable. So there's a two words which are used in food fortification, and those are restoration versus enrichment. So what is the restoration? Restoration means the bringing up the level of nutrients to the pre-processing or storage or handling level. The essential nutrients that get lost during the process of manufacturing or normal storage and handling procedures are restored. Whereas enrichment means bringing the nutrients to the pre-processing level solely. So here in enrichment, the nutrients are brought back till the level of pre-processing only and not the level of storage or handling. Though the term this enrichment has been used interchangeably with the fortification. So the next is adulteration of food. Adulteration of food, any material which is or could be employed for making the food unsafe or substandard or misbranded or containing extraneous matter is called adulteration of food. Any article is considered as adulterated in case it does not possess the substance or quality as required by the customer. If food contains other substances degrading the matter and quality of the food, if food is replaced by low quality substance, or if any ingredient of the food has been taken away, or if it contains any poisonous element, the food is considered to be adulterated. Prevention of Food Adulteration Act. Indian Parliament passed the PFA Act in 1954 with the main objective of safeguarding unadulterated and wholesome food to consumers and to guard consumers from dishonest trade practices. In 1955, the Central Committee for Food Standards framed the PFA rules. It was amended three times respectively during 1964, 1976 and 1986 to make it more stringent. In the state government enforces the act through the government public analyst and food inspectors, who has the power to check the supply, storage and marketing of food. The food inspector should draw and send the sample of food article to the laboratory for testing in case of suspected food adulteration. With the amendment of the Act in 1986, now consumer and the voluntary organizations can also take food samples. The sample collection, disposal and analysis. The food inspector informs the vendor in advance regarding the sample collection and its analysis as per the PFA Act. The vendor is paid for the cost of the food sample which is taken from shop or him. The signature of the vendor is also taken on the sample. The sample is packed and sealed in 3 packets. One sample is sent to the public analyst, to the lab, government lab, and another 2 samples are submitted to the local health authority for the safe custody. Local government public analyst conducts the analysis of sample and reports it to the local health authorities. If sample is proved as adulterated, court of law takes appropriate action. The vendor reserves the right to appeal in the court within 10 days and asking for analysis of the reserved samples which are kept with the state or local health authorities. Court may send reserved samples for reconfirmation to any of the 4 reference labs located at Mysore, Kolkata, Pune and Ghaziabad. So what is the punishment under this act? If the adulteration is proved as per the act, fine of Rs. 1000 within minimum imprisonment of 6 months is imposed. For the cases of adulteration which may result in grievous health problem or even death, within the meaning of section 320 of Indian Penal Code, the punishment of life imprisonment and the fine not be less than Rs. 5000 is imposed. So these are the some common food adulterants which are added intentionally or unintentionally. In the cereals we can have mud, grits. In the dal we have the kesari dal. Dyes are used. In dhania powder the horse dung and the cow dung are used. In haldi powder the lead chromate powder is used. For black pepper, the dried papaya seeds are added. In chili powder, the brick powder is added. In tea, the used tea dust and gram husk is added. In the milk, addition of starch and water, the fat extraction. In honey, the sugar and jaggery is added. In the mustard seeds, the prickly poppy seeds, agamon are added. For sweets, non-permitted colors are added. In ghee, especially the desi ghee, the banaspati is added. The edible oils, the mineral oils, the argamon oils are added. In ice cream, cellulose, starch and non-permitted colors are added. Now, these are the few examples which are common food adulterant. So here we finish the first part of the lecture. Rest of the lecture will be covered in the part 2. Thank you for listening. If you have any queries, you can send it to akshay@healthandfamily.in, and you are also requested to subscribe to this channel so other lectures and other health related information will be uploaded to this channel and you can have the access anytime. Thank you.